हेलो हेलो,
कंटिन्यू।
आई एम सॉरी, इट सीम्स दैट देर वॉज सम इश्यू ऑफ नेटवर्क, सो आई रिकैपिचुलेट व्हाट आई हैव स्टेटेड ए वेरी ब्रीफ इन 5 मिनट्स। हेलो, हाँ, यू सी, आई जस्ट रिकैपिचुलेट ब्रीफली। बॉम्बे रेंट्स होटल एंड लॉजिंग हाउस रेंट्स कंट्रोल एक्ट 1947 came into force with effect from 14th of February 1948. It is based on, originally it was based on the English Model Act, Rent Restriction Act. Like that in England, we also had a provision for transmission of tenancy in Section 511C, which provided that upon the death of a tenant, family member residing with him, in default of an agreement as may be decided by the court, would be entitled to inherit the tenancy rights. The situation therefore was that there was transmission of tenancy in favor of such family member. The word residing with the tenant, as it originally appeared in subsections C, 511C, created issues in the sense that there was a possible misinterpretation which was ultimately to happen by way of a law laid down by the Honorable Supreme Court in the case of Ganpat Lada versus Sasikant Vishnu Shinde in 1978 Supreme Court 955, in which the Supreme Court held, after of course on the merits, holding that person was not entitled to the protection on the merits of the case, the Honorable Supreme Court went on to hold that in any case, the protection would not extend to non-residential premises in view of the provision of the law. Now, that was a far-reaching judgment which immediately led the legislature to amend the provisions of law. Immediately, Maharashtra Act 22 of 1978 was introduced. That amendment introduced virtually a new provision in the nature of Section 511C, divided into two parts, C1 and C2. The original provision of 511C never provided for the transmission of tenancy, or we can say inheritance of tenancy, by the heirs. The words used by the legislature was that the family member of the tenant residing with him would entitle to tenancy rights. The amendment provided two important aspects. One, to give rights to the heirs, but that was a second kind of right. It's a right only in default of anybody fulfilling the character of a family member residing with the tenant. Then, if there was none, then only the heirs would get right and not otherwise. The second part of the amendment was legislature wanting no room for further interpretation, said that in case of a premises let out for education, business, trade, and storage, any family member who was residing with the tenant and doing such activities with the tenant would get the rights, and in default by the heirs, provided of course that in either case, that is in the case of family members or in the case of heirs, if there are more than one person qualifying or entitled to such inheritance of rights, there has to be decided by agreement first among themselves. In default of an agreement, the law provided, then heirs may be decided by the court. We were at that stage. Now, the court was given right to decide who is entitled to inherit among the several persons entitled to the same. Significantly, the landlord had no role to play at all. The landlord had no right to pick up any one of them of his choice as a tenant. And in order to avoid that mischief possibly, that a collusion with some of the members or some of the heirs could have led to jeopardy of the tenancy of the entire estate, that right was not given. In one of the matters in the Gujarat High Court, which went from a litigation started by the landlord on the for possession of premises on the tenant, out of several heirs, one of them was picked up by him without any agreement produced by the heirs or the family members, and without the decision of the court that that gentleman was entitled to qualify, and filed a suit for possession. He got decree for possession and succeeded in appeal as well. But the High Court did not agree with that, saying that landlord had no choice. Landlord had neither come out with the case that there was an agreement between the heirs or amongst the heirs or among the family members to appoint X, Y, Z or nominate that man as a tenant on their behalf. Because a tenancy which devolves on all those body of family members or heirs is one composite tenancy, what we call joint tenancy. So it is very significant that unless there was an agreement produced by the landlord or and a decree of the court declaring some one of the several people to be entitled to tenancy, landlord cannot file a suit against that person. The next question which fell for consideration was that who will be that person who is qualifying? If the court has to decide, how it's the court will decide? Then in a series of judgments, the guidelines have been laid down by the Bombay High Court that the court, while deciding such a suit for claim of tenancy in favor of only one amongst many, will consider several aspects. A, financial capacity. B, his moral character. C, is a person capable of contesting a possible litigation at the hands of the landlord, etc., etc. And only then that person will be declared as a tenant. Once there is an agreement amongst the heirs or family members, or once there is a declaration of tenancy in favor of one person, the landlord would file a suit against such person, and the decree against him would be binding on all, tenancy being one common amongst all. The second important aspect which the amendment of 78 brought into effect was to provide an explanation to section 511C. If we see the original provision of 511C, there was no such explanation, meaning or giving an possible interpretation that there will be only one succession of tenancy or one inheritance of tenancy, and then there is no second succession permissible. That was the English law at that time. As a result, the amendment of 1978 introduced explanation, making it clear that transmission of such tenancy is not restricted to the original tenant, but it will be successive transmission. So that one can say ad infinitum, the tenancy rights would devolve in the same manner rather than going back to the landlord. That is how 511C 1 and 2 were introduced on account of the effect of the judgment of the Supreme Court in the case of Ganpat Lada versus Sasikant Vishnu Shinde. The immediate feature which we find on this is that personal law of succession has been kept in background. If we see the scheme of the entire provision of law and our present section 715D of Maharashtra Rent Control Act is replica of the provision of section 511C 1 and 2 as it was introduced since after 1978. Therefore, the situation would be that heir had no right initially at all. Only a family member could inherit the tenancy rights. possibly expecting situation where there could be no such person qualifying as a family member residing with the deceased at the time of his death, and maybe the tenancy rights would fall through. The that not being the intention of law, the introduction was made about giving right to the heirs who are in second to hold. Otherwise, as was held in the case of case arising from the Bombay High Court, in the case of Sabnis versus Anyant Vithal Sabnis, where there was a possible bequest of tenancy created by the deceased tenant. A question arose before the Bombay High Court as to whether it was permissible to create a bequest of a tenancy under a will by the deceased. Obviously, therefore, there was a restriction under Section 15(1) of the Bombay Rent Act, which comes into play, which provided, we have got similar restriction in Section 26 of the present Act, which provided that the tenant shall not sublet or give on leave-in license basis, since after 1973 amendment, or assign or otherwise transfer his interest in favor of anybody. Now, the transfer by way of a will, what we call is an instrument of will, a bequest, would fall in the last category. And that was the view taken by the Supreme Court in the case arising from the Gujarat High Court in 1986, that a bequest of a tenancy under a will would breach the provisions of Section 15(1) and therefore will not give any tenancy rights. On the contrary, the tenant would stand to lose his rights during his lifetime if a suit were to be filed. The Bombay High Court took the similar view and going in greater detail of the law, suggesting that if the intention of legislature was not to give any right to either to the landlord or to the tenant to nominate any one of the family members or the heirs to inherit tenancy rights, it is to be governed by the statute, which was based on public policy. Any bequest made under a will in favor of a tenant, by a tenant in favor of one of the legatees, would obviously be void, contravening Section 511(c)(1), which was based on the principle of public policy, read along with Section 15(1) of the Bombay Rent Act 1947. And that is how that case of Anant Vithal Sabnis went right up to the Supreme Court, and Supreme Court confirmed the view of the Bombay High Court, holding that it is not permissible for a tenant to nominate, appoint or bequest tenants in favor of any one of them after his death. That is void. So neither landlord nor the tenant has a choice to accept. Neither can give up or confer any right on anybody. The provision being based on the public policy would be hit under Section 23 of the Indian Contract Act. And therefore, there was a complete law laid down that neither the landlord can elect nor can a tenant suggest that after me it would go to a certain particular person, only under the bequest, under my will. That was not permissible. The question then arose was, what is the nature of agreement? The Section 511(c)(1) and even 715(d)(1) is also not very happily worded. I would have expected the legislator to put some punctuation. If you read original provision also, that a person residing with the tenant at the time of his death, in default of an agreement by the court as may be decided. So I would have expected legislature to put a comma that any person residing with the deceased at the time of his death, comma, in default of an agreement, comma, as may be decided by the court. So first the agreement among the heirs, and then comes this. Situations do arise, even today we find day in and day out, that since the word agreement is not qualified by the word written. And in common parlance, agreement means agreement could be written, oral, or could be inferred from the conduct of a party. In several cases, the Bombay High Court had an occasion to reiterate this part of the law, where there were more than one person entitled to tenancy rights. There was no agreement amongst them, a formal agreement, no formal agreement. But amongst all the heirs, they, by their conduct, allowed one of them to pay rent and to accept receipt, which went on for sufficiently long period. The Bombay High Court held that this conduct and silence or no opposition by the other members or the family members or the heirs would convey their consent to such arrangement, and an implied agreement was culled out from this conduct, and it was held that in such situation, a decree passed against that man who was in that was last laid down in Ashok Jukar's case by the Honorable Supreme Court of India, that if the agreement was so culled out from the conduct of the parties, then the other persons who would have qualified who as to inherit tenancy cannot be allowed to have second or third round of litigation saying that I was not made a party. That was the whole idea, a principle of estoppel by conduct was placed into service, and once and for all, this law is now more than settled. We go to the next aspect. What is the meaning of the word family member? If we see the scheme of section 511C right from 14th February 1948, where the heirs were not in the picture at all, only family member is studying. Now, family member obviously has not been defined under the Bombay Rent Act. In almost all rent statutes which have got pari materia provisions throughout the country, there is no definition of family member. Often the court is required to go into the question of family member, deciding the definition of family member, either by resorting to dictionaries, as I'll point out very shortly, either Chambers 20th Century Dictionary referred or Osborne's Dictionary relating to the legal provisions. The Bombay High Court for the first time in somewhere in 1968 or thereabout had an occasion to consider a case where a kept or mistress who had been residing with the tenant who was all alone for best part of her life and always associated with the tenant, looking after the tenant throughout his life and looking after the needs as well. What we say is that prima facie, by the conduct, it would show as if it was a virtual marriage, though it was not. Such on the death of a tenant, such person who had a long association with such a person claimed tenancy rights, and relying on the two decisions of the English court, which were respectfully reported in the year 1949 All England reports and 1953 All England reports, in the cases of Smith versus Penny and Jones versus Whitehill, following the principles which are borrowed from the English law, and the law being virgin at that point of time, and the definition of family member not available under a statute, there was a very, very far-reaching judgment given by the learned judge of the Bombay High Court, who went on to hold that in such circumstances, there was a bond of family brought about by special circumstances. In other words, a very broad view was taken of interpretation of the word family member. If we dissect that two words, family member, would mean a person who is looked upon or treated as family member by the tenant. That is what, in my view and opinion, should be the view. And that is what the Bombay High Court held. However, with the passage of time, somewhere in 2002, the law came to be revised first by the judgment of His Lordship Justice Kochar in the year 2002, wherein His Lordship introduced the concept of blood relationship for the first time to become a family member. His Lordship did not agree with the view of the Bombay High Court laid down in the case of Kamal Chintaman versus that is in 1970 or thereabout, and said that no, there has to be such blood relationship established between the deceased tenant and the family member, not meaning the slighted disrespect to His Lordship. Prima facie, it would not appear to be in consonant the intention of the law. If the law wanted it, the legislature wanted it to be so, nothing would prohibit legislature from introducing those words. It was virtually rewriting the provisions of law, importing or reading something in the word of family member, namely blood relationship. If you look at from another angle, heirs by and large in the first degree would come in blood relations. And yet, in 1947 Act, which came into effect on 14 February 1948, the heirs had no right. Now, if we see these two, logical conclusion would be, in my humble view, that the legislature never contemplated that one has to be bloodly related, any blood relationship with the deceased, so as to qualify as a family member. The view was, of course, down the line followed by a couple of judgments. One of them is as recent as reported in February 2020 by Justice Gautam Patel. With highest respect to all these three judgments, one was of Her Ladyship Mrs. Roshan Dalvi, they all held that there has to be some blood relationship. In my humble view, and with utmost respect and regard to the learned judges of the who delivered all the judgments, I for one feel that all these three judgments and the views required to be revisited from three angles. Firstly, what was the intention of the legislature? If the legislature wanted to have this benefit to be conferred only to a person who was a blood relation, then it would not have used the broad word family members. Number two, if that were the intention, the heirs were not even in the picture of getting even right as a second category, namely in default clause. They were not there until 1978. So therefore, that was obviously not the intention. But since that act was borrowed from the English legislation, our Bombay High Court in the first judgment, in my view and humble opinion, rightly followed the two judgments of the English court in the cases of Smith versus Penny and Jones versus Whitehead. The reason being, it was in that case where the English courts held that family membership, one could be a person, a family member, on account of special bond of relations brought about by the circumstances. Instances are not uncommon, and in fact, times out of number we find that the closest blood relations of the tenant would be staying in distant area, either within the country or beyond India. Times out of number we find a distant relative or an absolutely unrelated person like cat, mistress or somebody, even a servant, domestic servant, who spends years and years, decades, to look after the tenant who is all alone in Mumbai or in any given place for that matter, while all his relatives are staying abroad or far off, unable to be contacted even. I have seen a number of cases personally, and I am sure many of you would have come across those situations when the letters are written by the sons, daughters, even the spouse staying abroad, that sorry, we can't come down, writing to the landlords, sorry, we can't come down, but XYZ, who is our distant relative, or XYZ, who is a domestic servant looking after my my relation, who is either by spouse or father or parent, whatever, he can be conferred tenancy rights. Now, this is what was the broad view possible, and that is why in its wisdom the legislature did not in the first instance give any rights to the heirs. Even when it gave the right to the heirs, they are in the second category, namely only if there was none fulfilling the character of a family member, then only they come into picture, not otherwise. If we go to the certain judgments of, in one of the judgments, His Lordship Justice Sonak has had to lay down the law in a situation where a distant nephew, very distant nephew, he claimed tenancy rights upon the death of the tenant. A near relative or a person claimed that no, he doesn't have right, I have right. The question which fell for consideration for His Lordship Justice Sonak was, as that was the case of Dharamvir Joshi versus Jayant Patwardhan, in which His Lordship Justice Sonak, not very far away, not in distant past, but in August 2015, held that the gentleman who was respondent before the court in the High Court, namely Mr. Jayant Patwardhan, he was entitled to, notwithstanding the fact that he was a very distant nephew, because he was the person who was all around by the side of the tenant till he expired. I have seen cases where the persons have given up their homes. They have given up their homes, natural parents, and gone to reside with the person who is all alone in the life. I may be forgiven to cite a concrete instance where in a huge premises in Churchgate, and very renowned doctor, I will not name, Parsi of course, was residing all alone, a huge and spacious flat, and he had a Catholic lady virtually of the age of his daughter, who had left her parental house in Marine Lines and had been residing with that gentleman doctor for over a period of 20-25 years. In his good days, bad days, she was by his side. Repeatedly he was required to be hospital. It was she who did it. As a result, it is a case where, with nobody near him, who was the person who acted as a family member? Did she not act as a family member? How do you import the words blood relations when legislature does not intend it to be? Till at least 22nd October 78. And even when it was introduced, when the heirs were given, they are given secondary rights, not the primary. Now, that being the list, the intention is very clear that such persons who spend their lives, who would be, in that case which I was mentioning, when the suit was filed by the landlord, I wanted Vakalatnama to be signed by that doctor. He was in his age of 93 at that time. I was asked that I'll bring the Vakalatnama. I said, no, I want to have his Vakalatnama signed in my presence. I went to his residence at Churchgate. He was on wheel. He told me with tears in his eyes that, Mr. Vyas, I want my daughter, this lady who is Christian, to inherit my tenancy rights, because nobody is near me. She is there with me for the last 25 years. She has given up her parents' house and is with me. He had scribed also a will. Now that will, which he had scribed, and he died very shortly thereafter, he did not survive the litigation at all. But the statement made by him in his will, his wish was that the person who has looked after me right since his childhood, more than like a daughter would do or to a parent, I feel that she is my daughter, I want, and she has been residing with me all these years. Now, obviously, on the basis of the will, she could not have claimed any assets because it cannot be bequeathed. But such statement in the will, such declaration in the will, such disposition in the will would give support to the court to come to a conclusion that the tenant was looking upon the servant as his family member. Now, how do we find out that how he or she was looked upon as a family member? It's by way of such circumstances. So that part of the evidence of the statement is admissible to show that even the deceased looked upon this lady as a family member. Second is, he had transferred all his belongings, innumerable fixed deposit receipts with the bank, bank accounts, everything was transferred in the joint names and she was operating that. Now, if these kind of questions are to be raised, how do we say that, where were the blood relations of this gentleman doctor when he died? None was in Mumbai for last 25 years. Now, what is the significance, therefore, of this law? Reading between the lines, the word blood relationship, which legislature in its wisdom has not incorporated. I thought it was virtually writing the provision of law, which is not permissible. But of course, we do respect the pronouncement of law at the same time. But it needs to be mentioned at this juncture that family member are not only under our rent act, but elsewhere in different part of the country do not describe who is a family member. Now, one of the provisions which we find in almost all the rent legislation is that the landlord is entitled to seek possession of premises to the tenant, let out to the tenant, on the ground that he or she requires it for his own benefit or for the benefit of his family members. Invariably, this word appears. See, there are a line of decisions in the Kerala High Court had taken under their law, in which consistently it was held that word family member has not been defined. We have to take an expansive or an expanding meaning of it, rather than taking a very rigid and narrow meaning. Because had the intention of the legislature was to minimize the definition, they could have definitely mentioned so. You see, there are four judgments of division bench of Kerala High Court taking the view that any person, including domestic servant, would fall in the category of family member within the meaning of Kerala Rent Control Act, with which they were concerned. A case in the arose for the full bench of Kerala High Court in the case of Raghavan versus Kelaiyappan, where their lordships had to consider a reference made by one division bench of the High Court. Four different division benches of the judgment had taken a consistent view that we have to take a very larger view of the matter, rather than taking only heirs as per the law. The full bench reconsidered the law after reciting all those four judgments, and the judgment under which a reference was made, with the help of dictionary meanings of family member given in both the dictionaries, namely Obsbawm's Law Dictionary as well as Chambers 20th Century Dictionary. Not to forget to mention taking the view of Bombay High Court in the case of Chintaman's case, that is way back in 1970, when this Bombay High Court held that domestic servant, even a cat, could be considered as an. There were three more judgments of Nagpur bench which were taken into consideration. Three different judgments of Madras High Court. Ultimately, to end that, the view taken by all these judgments and the four decisions of division bench would prevail, and the ward family members would cover and embrace all persons living with the tenant, notwithstanding whether they are only blood relations, namely, or the spouses, blood relations, etc., but even dependents and domestic servants. That was the judgment given by the full bench of Kerala High Court in Raghavan. It needs to mention at this juncture one more aspect. In a similar provision out of the East Punjab Rent Restriction Act and another from UP Rent Restriction Act, the Supreme Court had different points. In one, in the case of Joginder Pal's case, the Supreme Court had to consider what is the meaning of family members. The Honorable Supreme Court says that it has to be given a very meaningful and larger connotation. It has to be interpreted more than the persons who are family blood relations. It has to include even the servants if they are residing with the tenant. And their lordship says that in a case where landlord wants the premises for his personal occupation as for family members, and on account of his sickness or illness, he requires some domestic servants or wards by his side 24 hours a day, 7 days in a week, 30 days in a week, in a month, and 365 days in a year, such person would fall in the category of family member. And the Supreme Court says, landlord can seek possession on the ground that not he seeks possession also for those attendants and servants. Similar view was taken in a somewhat recent judgment, somewhere in 2011 or 12, if I mistake not, by the Supreme Court in a case arising from Allahabad High Court, where there were two domestic persons, servants or wards required for the landlord who was ailing round the clock to be by his side. A question arose that I have got premises, but it is not enough. I want some independent rooms for my wards to sleep in because they are also my family members. They are with me. They are living with me. The criteria is they are living with me and I need for them. The Supreme Court says yes, that requirement of such a landlord would include the requirement of domestic servants who are attending them because they qualify within the meaning of what we call family members. Now, family members once not defined. I thought these judgments ought to be given some prominence. They ought to have been brought to the notice of the courts and the law laid down by some of the later judgments which did not approve the 69 Bombay judgment are required to be reviewed and recalled. See one more aspect. While in a judgment which is reported somewhere in 2004 in the Supreme Court, a question arose as to what is the meaning of Section 511(c)(1), who are the family members, who are the heirs. Dealing with the family members, first their lordship say, family members would definitely, heirs would include definitely those defined in the personal law of succession. As far as with regard to family members are concerned residing with the tenant, the Supreme Court says, by such persons, making a distinction between the heirs, such persons have to prove something more. And what is that something more? A, that the tenant looked upon such person as his family member. And how does one find that he was looked upon as a family member? An instrument saying so. The behavior of the tenant vis-a-vis those persons, the inclusion of names of such person in the investments, etc., inclusion of the name of such person in the ration card of the tenant as a family member, and the conduct of the tenant in totality, that he looked upon these persons as family members. In other words, even the judgment of the Supreme Court under the Bombay Rent Act makes a distinction between the heirs and family members in this manner. that for IRS, nothing is required to be proved except those who are covered in those successions provided in different statutes, personal law of succession. But for others, namely family members, something is more required. I for one believe and firmly believe that those two lines of the Supreme Court judgment under the Bombay Rington gives a complete picture that there are other persons who are entitled to tenancy apart from blood relations. And I thought all these recent judgments, starting from Justice Kochar, Justice, I believe, Roshan Dalvi, and Justice Gautam Patel, with due respect and absolutely not meaning the slightest disrespect for them, are required to be revisited and viewed from this angle, considering similar expression of family members interpreted by various courts. And the question is this: if Karnataka, if Kerala High Court full bench, which decides the matter in 2005, to be very precise, 16th November 2005, resorts to the Bombay High Court judgment with approval, there is no reason why Bombay High Court should not follow the judgment. And along with certain other Supreme Court judgments which are delivered, as I mentioned earlier, on the ground of requirement, the law is definitely required to be revisited. And if we see the provisions of law again in light of these judgments, then intention of the legislature is blood relations were never expected to receive, because only a family member of person entitled to receive. That family member, of course, would include normally spouse, sons, that is children, and other residing with them, or grandchildren. But the question is, that was not the intention. Otherwise, they could have straight away been enumerated in the provision. But beyond them, there are certain persons who qualify to be family members because of the bond of family brought about on account of special circumstances. And that is precisely what the first judgment of the Bombay High Court held, that in the case of Kamal Chintaman case, that relationship of family is brought about by special bond of circumstances. This bond of relationship is brought about special set of circumstances. Cat or a mistress who has been looking after the tenant is entitled to tenancy, and that view is accepted by all the courts, Kerala High Court and Karnataka, repeatedly. And almost in the same lines, when the Supreme Court says that if a landlord can require possession of a premises on the personal requirement for the attendants or servants or domestic servants or wards attending him who qualify as family members, why should such persons not qualify to become family members in the meaning of, in the broader connotation of Section 511(c)(1), namely family member. It needs to be mentioned here, if we see the philosophy in this provision, and those who do not know Sanskrit would pardon me, in the one of the most important person who is a bandhava, means, if we have a broader connotation, bandhava would not only mean brother but a friend, or whosoever stands by the side of a person in his difficult times. It is said in the Shastras, Rajyadware smashanecha yahatisthati sa bandhava. So if our scripture say that a person who stands with the person in the time when in old days a summon from Raja or a king was a very dangerous thing to be even visualized, or in a smashan when somebody loses his dear one. In other words, person who would stand by the side of another during his difficult situation is the real bandhava. राज्य द्वारे स्मशान यह तिष्ठति स बांधव. नाउ इफ द टेनेंट इज लेफ्ट अलोन टू डाई इन मुंबई, हिज फैमिली मेंबर्स हु आर रिसाइडिंग मैरिली आउटसाइड इंडिया और मे बी आउटसाइड, दे जस्ट ड्रॉप इन अ कॉन्डनेंस लेटर एंड से दैट वी आर सॉरी प्लीज एंड एक्सप्रेस थैंक्स टू द पर्सन वॉज नेक्स्ट टू हिम. आई डोंट सी एनी रीजन वाई सच पर्सन शुड नॉट बी गिवन टेनेंसी राइट्स. I humbly request that in a given case the matter is required to be revisited. Not meaning that the learned judges were not correct. I dare not make that statement. I have full respect and I can't go beyond that. But it is required to be revisited in light of the intention of the legislature. If we see from, and possibly that was not argued. I have read Justice Kocher's judgment, Justice Gautam's Patel's judgment is cursorily read, so I am unable to make a positive statement. It has not gone into the legislative history of that provision of Section 511C. 511C, as it stood up to 23rd October 1978, had no heirs in the picture at all, only family members. So the legislature never wanted to give that kind of thing. I personally feel that the law requires to be gone into again. It's an ever-expanding law. With the passage of time, it has got to have, I would say, a purposive interpretation of the word family member. And instead of making more and more narrower definition, let us enlarge that definition, that family member should include many, many more persons than only blood relations. I believe that there is lot to be stated on this subject, but in a brief time of such situation, I think I have given a cursory and a broad idea of the provisions of law relating to transmission of tenancy, which is, as state, I reiterate, is now not restricted to single transmission. It is made transmission in ad infinitum for times immemorial. And I must seek your apology and seek pardon for having that short issue of transmission. And that's all that I can say. And I wish I have made it meaningful. I welcome questions on from anyone, from everyone on this topic to be answered by me. And I'll try my best to satisfy them. Thank you all. Akul? पहला कह दीजो कौन चाहिए लाला नहीं लेट यू आस्क पूछो अच्छा आ रही थे अच्छा आमा आवेलू से So, person is living in a Baithichal on a trust property having sale deed of a hut. Sale deed? A number and tax assessment received by the municipal corporation can make will in respect of the same property. VL. The question put up by VL that if a person is living in a Baithichal, in a trust property having sale deed of the hut and the tax assessment. You see, from the very reading of your query, it's very clear that whether it is by Baithichal or whatever, it's a property in which the person has a saleable interest because he has got a document of sale in his favor, so it becomes definitely transferable in law. બીજું કોણ છે? આને બધું
ગુલાબસિંહ યાદવ.
Advocate Gulab Singh Yadav has put up a question: what would be the consequence of in case of dispute between legal heirs and relation arising from illegal relationship? See, the question is this: if they are on the same platform, in the sense, if such person was, both the set of persons are very starting with the deceased at the time of the death, if there is no agreement, then as per the provisions of section 511c 1 and 2, it will be decided by the court depending upon the various situation. But suppose if the heirs arising from legal relationship would definitely be entitled to tenancy rights, and provided and of course a right of precedence if such heirs were, such persons were residing and not the real legal heirs. Real legal heirs are in the second category, what has been laid down by the Bombay High Court and approved by the Supreme Court, in the category of exclusion in Anand Trambak Sabnis's case. They are excluded. Only if there is no one fulfilling the first part, then the heirs come into picture. So then the tenancy rights do not fall through. They don't go and reversion interest would not go back to the landlord in such situation. Then the heirs need not be staying in order to qualify in the second part to be staying with the tenant. It's enough if they were staying anywhere. But so long as there is one family member, as Mr. Gulab Singh Yadav says, if a child of an illegal relationship was residing with the tenant, he succeeds to the tenant's rights in preferential right over to that of an heir who was not residing there.
Read out the question.
Raksha Thakkar has put up a query. Tenant who died while pursuing the suit for declaration and possession dies during the pendency of his legal heir claim, tenancy. Tenant who died, I mean, it's not very clearly. Tenant who died while pursuing suit for declaration, okay, and possession, dies during the pendency of the pendency. Can his legal heirs claim? Obviously. See, the legal heirs, again, make a distinction. If a person was claiming tenancy rights, and if his heirs or family members who come in the first category, being residing with the deceased at the time of his death, notwithstanding the fact that the tenant died or tenant did not survive the litigation, he can definitely step into the suits. He or they can claim tenancy rights without any difficulty. There is no denying that fact. Mr. Virendra Lalani has put up a query. Disowned son by a tenant, can landlord recognize him as heir under the Rent Act? See, disowned heir vis-a-vis the tenant, vis-a-vis the landlord. Question is this: so long as tenant is alive, the right of such person who has been disowned to be his heir would not arise. If the question arises only upon the death of a tenant, whether his son is disowned by him or not, so long as he is a person who qualifies under 511c, he becomes entitled to claim. The landlord has no right, no role to play in that at all. Now, Mr. Anand Nayak's query: niece started residing at 6 months prior to the death of tenant to look after the tenant. Can he succeed? Very often this question arises, as Mr. Anand Nayak has raised. We have to see our Rent Act, 511c1 and now present section 715d1 does not qualify the word residing with any period. See, in the counterpart in Bombay Rent Act applicable to Gujarat, somewhere in 1965 or thereabout, the Gujarat government had brought in an amendment stating that such a person to qualify, a person as a family member to qualify tenancy rights, inherit tenancy rights, should have minimum 3 months residence. Now, that gives an idea that if a law applicable to Gujarat specifically mentions 3 months' time, and our act does not specify, means even if the niece has come for a short period to occupy the premise, he would be entitled to tenancy and without any difficulty, without any dispute. Priya Thakkar, can a commercial tenancy being go down be transmitted? Yes, since after 78 amendment in the provisions of Bombay Rent Act, and now under the present Act 7, 15D 1 and 2, there is a specific provision that even the commercial premises can be inherited, transmitted to the heirs, depending upon the circumstances, either in the family member or falling as an heir. Definitely, there is no restriction at all. G.K. Shah, if there are no family members and no direct heirs of the tenant, can distant cousin claim tenancy who was not staying with the tenant at the time? You see, distant cousin. So if there was nobody residing with the tenant at the time of his death, but if there is a distant cousin, it has to be shown under the, say for example, he is a Hindu person. Then under the Hindu Succession Act, there are categories of exclusion. First category, exclude the others. If there is no one in the first, the second line of succession comes, then the third. So such a person, if he is covered within the rule of succession in the respect to personal law of succession, would definitely be entitled to claim tenancy, not with the fact that he is a distant cousin and though he was not residing, because he will fulfill the character or he will fulfill the qualification as an heir. Of course, with the proviso, he should be heir under the concerned law of succession, not otherwise. I propose to close. I believe there are no further queries coming forward. May I close the lecture? Thank you.